Welcome all of you to Arapahoe Basin. My name is Alan Hensroth. I'm the Chief Operating Officer here. And I'd like to welcome you to our panel discussion today, the future of skiing, the science behind the snow. Great turnout today. I appreciate everybody coming. This is very exciting for us. There's a few people that really did a lot of work to pull this together. We're doing this project in conjunction with PAL, Protect Our Winters. And Lindsay Burgoyne is here from PAL today. She's got all kinds of great information about PAL and thoughts for you. Feel free to look her up after the presentation. Also here I have Elizabeth Maroon, who's a climate scientist down at CU, and a couple of Arapahoe Basin staff, our sustainability team, sustainability managers, which is Shaw Miklas. Where are you?
Downstairs.
Shaw's downstairs. And Mike Nathan right behind you. So thank these guys. They did a lot of work to pull all of this together. We have three outstanding people here. Jim White, who's a paleoclimatologist and biochemist at CU. Jim and Katja Friedrich, who is an atmospheric scientist also at CU. And Keith Musselman, who is a mountain hydrologist down at the National Center for Atmospheric Research. This is Shaw Miklas right up here in the front. I introduced you when you were out.
Sorry.
That's okay. That's okay. You know, there's probably no issue greater to Arapahoe Basin than weather and climate. I mean, nobody pays more attention to precipitation and temperatures than those of us that work at the ski areas, especially here at Arapahoe Basin. You know, for us, we have five really important keys to success that kind of shape us moving forward. Some of those things are obvious. You know, we need to be a good, solid, profitable company. We need to create a good environment for our employees. We need to provide great services. Is that a little better?
Sure. I don't know if it's on. Mm-hmm.
Just got to turn the speaker up.
Okay. Can you guys hear me okay, or do we need this, do you think?
We need that.
We need it, okay. Okay. Just turn the speaker on, Mike.
Yep.
How's that sound?
Mic switch up.
Yep. Can you hear this?
Okay.
Very good. So I was saying there's five keys to success for us. You know, we need to provide great services for the people that visit us. And then a couple of other things that are also very critical. We need to be a community leader. And it's important for us to be a leader on the sustainability front. And it's really a pleasure for us to do an event like this with these people. And, you know, I've had the pleasure of working for the last 34 years, mostly at Arapahoe Basin, a few years down in Keystone. I can't wait to hear what these guys have to say. I have some observations, what I've looked and seen and felt over that time. And, you know, they are, in the first half of my career, we certainly felt like we had a lot more really cold, bitter days. I mean, it was not uncommon for us to have several days in the minus 30 range here, and we just don't see that quite as much. Now, hitting minus 20 might be a really big deal in the wintertime. And the other thing is that, you know, spring is coming earlier at Arapahoe Basin. Although we're known for staying open for skiing into June, sometimes July, once even into August. But there's no doubt spring's coming a little bit earlier. We're working harder to make things happen, to keep us going into the spring. So I'm going to give each of these guys, we'll start with Katja, a moment to introduce themselves and share a few thoughts.
Thank you, Adam, and thank you so much for the invitation. I think it's a great idea, and I think you're all very excited to be here. So my name is Katja Friedrich. I am a professor at the University of Colorado in the Department of Atmospheric and Oceanic Sciences. And my research is related to all kinds of precipitation and cloud systems. So primarily I look at severe weather. This can be thunderstorms. You look on the upper left corner. This is not in the winter. This is a summertime thunderstorm in Denver. And we are trying to identify thunderstorms that actually dump a lot of hail on the ground. And this is becoming more and more a problem. We don't know if this is a Twitter-related problem or if this is really something, maybe even climate change-related problem. We also look at reservoir evaporation. If you might have heard that Colorado set up a new water plan for the next 10, 20 years. And we are looking at what is the role of evaporation. So we temperatures are increasing, so we have the water is warmer, so we are evaporating more water, and more people are moving to the west, so we need more water. Is there any way we can actually capture that water and preventing it from evaporating? I'm also looking at high impact event on the upper left corner, right corner. You can see pictures. Does anyone remember that? The big flood. So this is what we call the Great Colorado Flood in 2012. So we looked at how did this evolve, and is there anything we can learn for the future that we can maybe better predict or maybe even ever better forecast that. And then a new project that we just took on is we're looking at fire weather, how thunderstorms impact wildfires, and whether we can actually better predict or predict at all how these thunderstorms affect fires and vice versa. So this is one of the latest projects. I'm really excited about this. I just came back from a field campaign in Idaho, and we were seeding clouds. And what you can see on the left-hand side, this is how much snow we got. So we had remote instruments, like up there, we had a radar, and you can see after 2 months, we got totally snowed in. We actually had to abandon the site. Down there, you see a gigantic snow plow, and on the left-hand side, this is the amount of snow that we saw. But what was actually interesting was that we could see, for the first time, a seeding signal. So if you see clouds, and I think we'll talk about this later, this is how this will look like. We had a seeding aircraft, and then you can see, if you put silver iodide in these clouds, how you can actually generate precipitation. Okay, so this was a really long introduction.
That's perfect.
My name is Keith Musselman. I'm a mountain hydrologist. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the National Center for Atmospheric Research, NCAR, in Boulder. And so as a mountain hydrologist, I'm interested in quantifying interactions between the atmosphere and the land surface, particularly interested in water resources. So I study the availability of fresh water in mountainous areas and the ways in which water then kind of evolves throughout this landscape. And I do that both in a current, in the past, and in a future climate to understand the physics and the mechanisms that kind of dictate our natural world as it relates to water and energy. One of the ways mountain hydrologists and myself in particular monitors snowpack in Colorado, but also across the western North America, is with snow pillows. Snow pillows are not exactly what it sounds like, but they're these flat metal plates that are filled with antifreeze solution, and there's a pressure reading that gives us the weight of the snowpack. There are over 1,000 stations scattered across the West, mostly in forested and high alpine areas that monitor our water resources. This is a picture of one of the stations at Niwot Ridge, just up from Netherlands. And this is, I'm about to show a time lapse that starts on April 8th, so last year today. And it's going to go through the spring and show the end of the accumulation season and the start of the melt season. These are processes that we observe in nature, but also as scientists, we then try to create models, mathematical equations that will replicate just this. On the left, we see time series. This is daily over from October to the summer temperature. It's blue if it's below freezing, it's red if it's above freezing. In the middle there, the dashed line is the snowpack, so the amount of water in the snow. You can see it increases from October pretty steadily up until May, when we get that sharp melt. And then at the bottom, that's snow depth. So we're going to start that line, that vertical line is going to move to the right, and you can see we're not going to go very far before we get the last big snow event of the season. Almost a meter of snow falls last year, and then it's going to melt out. So if you could start that video. All right, so here we go. We're going towards this snow event. We're about to see a meter of snow fall. It accumulates. We see things interacting with the vegetation, the forest, interception, of small storm events, of large storm events, that ultimately affects how much water ends up on the land surface. And then we get into the spring. You can see that what we call the Death Star. The sun is melting our snow, and it's very quickly going to bare ground. So we get all these feedbacks between the time of the year, the amount of energy in the sun, and water availability, for example, in the soils, available then to the ecosystems, to the trees, and ultimately to stream flow for downstream interests. I think that's the last slide I have. Yeah, so I'm going to quote the great Warren Miller here. If you don't have any idea where you're going, you'll probably end up there. You can imagine him saying that in one of his great movies in the 80s and 90s. But the idea is that we're doing just fine right now. We're having a great time skiing in Colorado and across the West. But we need to have a better sense of where we're headed, both as skiers, as protectors of the environment, but also for future generations. Can you click the next slide? You know, it's not just about our generation, but our kids. Like, you know, what kind of experiences are they going to have in the mountains, and what are the water resources going to mean for future generations? And that's some of the work that I'm most interested in.
Hi, I'm Jim. Whoa.
I can't hear.
Elevate
well,
this
I know you need help, Lindsay.
If that were to go up on this table, that would help a lot.
I've known that for some time now.
That's even...
All right. While the crack AV team works on the system here. I'm Jim White. I'm a professor at the University of Colorado. My research has been in the areas of something called paleoclimate. So what I do is I look into the past. I use things like ice cores to try to understand how the climate system has varied in the past. I have also spent about 30 years studying the carbon cycle. If you put carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, what happens to it? And I also think it's fair to say that over my career, particularly when it comes to public events, my scientific approach has devolved. I've gone from the complex down to the, let's get to the simple stuff. So let's go to the next slide. So I'm going to tell you, you need to know physics. If you didn't pay attention in high school and college, you should have. If not, go back and learn a little. I'm going to teach you three things about physics here in the next minute. One is heat capacity. All right? Heat capacity is how much temperature increase for a unit of energy absorbed. All right? Remember heat capacity. You're going to come back to it. Second thing you need to know is that everything radiates energy, including you, including the Earth. Everything radiates energy. The third thing you need to know is that all molecules vibrate and absorb energy of their inherent frequency. If you only know those three physical principles, if I go to the next slide, you know a heck of a lot about climate. Right? Global climate really only depends on three factors. How much energy do we get from the sun? Okay, that's determined by how close, basically, the planet is to the sun and how hot the sun is. The second is how much of that energy is reflected back to outer space by this wonderful stuff outside, by the white bits, by the snow, by the clouds and stuff. The third thing you need to know is the amount of greenhouse gases. And that's why I told you had to understand two of those three physical principles. The one about everything radiates and the one about all molecules vibrate. Because the Earth radiates in the infrared energy to outer space, and because there are molecules in the atmosphere that absorb infrared radiation, you have something called greenhouse gases. These are gases like water vapor, CO2, methane, that absorb the Earth's outgoing radiation and warm our planet up. Next slide, please. And not by a small amount. If you were to measure our temperature at the top of the atmosphere without in other words, how much energy we get from the sun, our temperature should be about negative 18 degrees C, right? That's cold. Don't worry about translating at C to F, it's cold. The temperature that we measure down here on the surface of the Earth is actually about plus 15 degrees C, which is pretty warm, it's quite nice. There's about a 33 degrees temperature difference, Celsius, that's about 60 degrees Fahrenheit temperature difference that is due to greenhouse gases. It's due to water vapor, it's due to CO2, it's due to methane. So the greenhouse effect is not only real, but it takes us from a point of it's too darn cold to live on this planet to a point where you got a pretty nice, warm, cozy place to live, all right? So those are two of the three physical principles that you need to understand. If you understood everything radiates and molecules absorb, then you understand greenhouse gases. Next slide, please. So if we add lots of greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, and we have, there will be more energy in the atmosphere. Energy in the atmosphere is by definition climate. And climate will change, right? This is a physical law. Belief is not an option. I get asked the question a lot. Do you believe in climate change? It's like saying, do you believe in gravity, for crying out loud? Yes, I believe. Well, I don't know. No, I don't really believe in gravity. Gravity is. You know, physical laws are, right? The third piece of information that I told you need to understand was heat capacity. And I want to loop back to a slide that was shown earlier. And that has to do with the fact that you live on a water planet, okay? You can leave it on this slide. You live on a water planet. Because you live on a water planet, water has high heat capacity. And high heat capacity means that it takes a long time for the planet to warm up. And it takes a long time for the planet to cool off. That's important because today you've got 400 parts per million CO2 in the atmosphere. That's a very, very, very warm planet, folks. You don't have a 400 ppm climate yet because the ocean hasn't warmed up yet, but it will. So climate change in itself is inherently an intergenerational problem. What we do with the atmosphere today, our kids and our grandkids are going to have to live with. Until we start thinking 50 to 100 years down the road, until one generation looks at its kids and say, I value you more than I value my short-term profits, we're not ever going to solve climate change. The end of my speech. Maybe for our first question here, we can go down to the very basics and you guys could chat for a minute about the difference between climate and weather and climate change and climate variability.
That's a
gotcha. Yeah, that's something for to lecture my students on. Okay, so this is a question that's also very, very important because people mix it up. So most of the things that you currently hear in the media is a mix-up between climate and weather. Okay, so weather are short-term things. You look at the weather forecast for next week, even for next month, this is weather. If you have a cold air outbreak last winter or this winter, this is weather, you know. Even if people say, oh, we have a cold air outbreak, it's really cold, oh, what about climate change? This is not climate, this is weather. So every short-term changes, and it can even be annual throughout the year, even if you look at the seasonal forecast, this is what we consider weather. However, if you take this weather, whether it's temperature or whether it's precipitation, and you look back 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, 100 years, thousands of years, and you average over this time period, then you become, then you are in the climate framework. So this is really important. Climate is something long-term, has a really long-term overturn period, so it's really also even difficult to change one way or the other, while weather is more higher variability, shorter term, and you can have extreme, and that's the weather will vary and climate will vary as well. We talk about this, but this is really important that you don't mix up, even for political reasons, do not mix up weather with climate.
Okay. Well, how has climate changed in the past, and how is that different from what's going on today?
Climate has changed in the past. Our planet has been through warmer times, it's been through colder times. And those three things I told you that control climate, how much sun, reflectivity of the planet, and greenhouse gases, those features have changed naturally in the past. And when we've been farther away from the sun, we've been colder. When we've been closer to the sun, we've been warmer. When we've had more greenhouse gases in the atmosphere like we had 40 million years ago, then this planet was warmer. Right? So we know, so the physics of climate change have, so physics is physics, and it happens from when the Earth began to now. What's important to recognize is that because we've had different climates in the past, we can actually get some idea of, yes, if you raise CO2 to this level, what's the climate system, what's it gonna look like? How high is sea level gonna be? How much snow is there gonna be? All right, so we have, since we have this planet that's been through changes, that's a nice thing because we can actually look in the past and go, where, what did the planet look like when it was warmer? What did it look like when it was colder? Okay. Now, on top of that, We also understand from the physical principles that we can pull out, we can build models. And so that's the other thing, and I'll let these guys address that. But the you hear a lot about climate models. Climate models are just basically, let's take the best physics we can and apply that, put that into a computer, turn the crank and see what happens. But we also can look into the past and say what happened in the past. And because climate has changed, we're able to actually calibrate those models. And so I think you should have a great deal of faith in those models.
Maybe we can talk about these slides now that we're on this. I'll just talk for a minute and I hand over to Keith. So we brought you some slides. Also talking about variability and what Jim just talked about. So what you can see here is temperature records from 1910 until 2010. So these are observations throughout Colorado. I guess I can move. Okay, so you see here the Rocky Mountains, and you see everything color-coded. And then for each region, we took out some examples of what the temperature looked like over the last 100 years. And what's really important is that you can see the temperature increased, in particular over the last 20 years, in most areas. However, we also have areas where the temperature remained almost the same throughout the time. And we even have areas like here, the southeastern corner, where we have observations where the temperature decreased over time. So it's really important that we have some kind of a variability that could go one or the other way. However, if you look at these slides, you can see that most of these stations, the temperature increased, in particular over the last 10, 20 years. And you can see that in these red bars, that you have more on this side than you used to have here. And then Keith is going back in time.
Yeah, so we can go back a little further using tree rings in Colorado particularly. So this is because trees are sensitive to local climate conditions such as rain and temperature, they do provide a lot of information, particularly when you find some of the older trees in the state. The wider the ring is generally meaning a more productive environment for that ecosystem, usually related to more precipitation, more water availability. And in Colorado, particularly in the high country, 85% of our water comes in the form of snow. So you can make these correlations between tree ring thickness going back 550 years in some cases and current observed snowpack maybe over the last 80 years, if we have 80 years of record, and then get these correlations and then run it back and see what the historical snowpack was. Over the next slide. This is starting with temperature. So if you do the same thing with temperature, relating historical temperature to tree rings, in Colorado we see this increase, exactly what Katya showed over the last 30 to 40 years, increase in temperature in the black line.
Wait a minute.
Yep.
I'm gonna channel my cousin Vanna.
But you can also see great variability within that signal, and I think that variability is really important to hone in on and say, it's possible that we could see 5 years of continuous below average temperatures and potentially 3 or 4 years of potentially above average temperatures. And this is kind of a natural variability that might be multi-decadal. It might be every century that we see that. If you go to the next slide. So this is a reconstruction now of snowpack going back 431 years. And so the observed record goes back really to 1950. You can see we have some spikes, but we don't have the spikes in terms of the very big snow years, in terms of the very dry snow years that we've seen over the last 300 to 400 years. So it's possible, you know, it's not out of the realm of possibility that we get 7 years of drought, of 5 years of drought, like California has seen. This is possible, and it's also possible that we see 3 years of really above average snowpack, and that's not necessarily a climate signal or an anthropogenic climate signal per se, but that we're thinking that now we've got this new anthropogenic trend that we're going to be superimposing on top of this variability, and that's what we're worried about.
Well, how do we, or what are the most concerning impacts of climate change, particularly global warming, and how do we know that these are man-caused?
Attribution.
Okay. Yeah, you talk about how we know that. Okay. So what are the impacts? I think really the impact depends on where you live. The impact, if we have rising temperatures, we have rising sea levels, we have also most likely more extreme events, we have less snow, we have smaller snowpacks. So it depends really where you live, what are the impacts. If you have a resort in Florida, then of course you have to be concerned about sea level rise. Here in Colorado, we are not really concerned about sea level rise, but we are concerned about wildfire activity, which might increase if we have drier years or a year of drought. We're very concerned about water resources in particular, because more people are moving into Colorado. Can we really sustain that for the next 50 years? Ski resorts have concern about snowpack and how does the snowpack look in 10 years, 50 years, 100 years. So it really depends on where you live. I mean, there are certainly areas that might even benefit from a warmer climate. There are areas that will not benefit. So it really depends on where you live, and it can be very extreme, but the impact can be relatively mild. But what is really, really the important thing to understand, and I think, is adaptation. So we need to understand this is happening, and we don't really want to be too pessimistic by saying it's happening, but really the important thing is that we adapt, that we adapt our water resources, that we adapt our way of living. This is the most important thing, so that we can actually use the resources mindfully in the next 10, 50, 100 years and for the next generations.
So the second part of the question was, how do we know this is caused by human beings? This is not a difficult answer. The amount of carbon dioxide we have in the atmosphere today is about 100 parts per million higher than it was in the early 1900s. So, and to put that in, so you might say, what's 100 parts per million among friends? keep in mind that the difference in CO2 between warm periods and glacial periods when glaciers covered the Rocky Mountains, when they covered Canada, the difference between warm periods and glacial periods is 100 parts per million. So it was about 280 parts per million during warm periods, about 180 parts per million during cold periods throughout the last million years. So you've got several of these things that you can see. So is 100 parts per million a lot? Yes. 100 parts per million is what nature did in the last million years. We've done that in the last 75 years. Right? So that's step number one to understand. Step number two is to realize that if you look at an extra 100 parts per million CO2 in the atmosphere, we've actually put enough CO2 in the atmosphere from burning of coal, oil, natural gas, and deforestation to raise CO2 by 200 parts per million in the atmosphere. As it turns out, nature is our friend, and nature naturally removes some of the CO2 we put in the atmosphere. About half of that goes in the ocean, naturally, and about half of it has led to plant growth. Plants have increased the amount of carbon they absorb. But plants in the ocean have not been able to keep up with the amount that we've put in the atmosphere. Now, I can go really geeky on you if you want me to, right? So as it turns out, the carbon that you take out of the ground with fossil fuels, that stuff's been in the ground for millions of years. There are radioactive isotopes of carbon, carbon-14. And there's no carbon-14 in fossil fuels because it's so old. So when we burn fossil fuels, you can directly measure the decrease of carbon-14 in the atmosphere because you're adding no carbon-14 when you burn fossil fuels. So there are ways that we can fingerprint this stuff very effectively. And so this is not a surprise that human beings are increasing CO2 in the atmosphere, and it's not a surprise that we can attribute that to our activities. By the way, I mean, I think one of the coolest things that's happened in my lifetime is satellites that look back down on the Earth. So today, I got an app on my phone that'll show me what the planet looks like today. And you can see the lights on the dark side of the planet. You can see all of those lights. And it's, you know, New York is lit up, and Denver's lit up, and it's not a surprise that we burn lots of fossil fuels, because all of those lights are driven, or not all of them, but 85% is coal, oil, and natural gas. That's enough. I think that horse is flogged.
Does anybody have any questions for these guys at this time?
Yes.
Can you talk about aerosols in the atmosphere and black carbon pollution that's affecting the snowpack?
Thought you can.
Yeah, sure. So, in the atmosphere, and so aerosols have increased. We are currently studying like how these aerosols have impact on clouds. So again, aerosols can have two kind of impacts. They can have radiative impact because they can heat up and they can store heat. But they can also be used for what we call cloud condensation nuclei. So in order for cloud droplets to form, you need to have little tiny particles. So what can happen is if you put in more aerosols in the atmosphere, you produce more smaller drops. These more smaller drops, they are so small they might float in the atmosphere, so they don't come down, so it can suppress rain. So aerosols are actually have a large impact on the climate and also on clouds and in the direct and the indirect effect. What was the second part of your question?
Black carbon.
Yeah, so this is also, so black carbon are these dark particles that are in the atmosphere and they fall on the snowpack. And then the snowpack, instead of having a white surface, which reflects a lot of sunlight, we have a darker surface and that absorbs more of the energy and therefore stores the heat that is then actually transferred to the snowpack, and then so you melt the snowpack quickly. So the problem is not just black carbon, it's also brown carbon, so things that are not as dark as black carbon. So yeah, so this is another problem that we are dealing and we're trying to understand the different feedback mechanisms, but this is another way of how we change the climate and how we affect the climate.
Any other questions? Yes, Gary.
How can each of us individually, however many people there are in this room, do one thing every day that would affect climate change?
Go out and vote.
And make it an educated vote.
And convince other people to vote.
And no, I agree 100%. I think that's the, you know, we've learned that votes have consequences. And I think it's absolutely essential that we educate ourselves about this and then speak out and say, yes, we care about this. If you care about skiing, if skiing is something that you would like to see continue to happen here in Colorado, this is something that you ought to care about, and it's something you ought to take into account when you go into the voting booth, or when you do it online, or wherever you do it.
Great question, great answer also. Yes?
I'm interested in why, and maybe this is just too complex for this, but why is this a partisan issue? It just seems like it seems like such a strange thing. And some people have suggested that maybe it was the Al Gore film that he started it out, raising awareness, and he had a D behind his name, and so it suddenly became a resistance point for the other side, the other side.
But you know what, we're gonna pass on that question,
because
the spirit of this talk is the science behind the snow.
Okay,
so let's stay focused there, and although I'm sure we could have a lot of fun with that, but let's bring this a little closer to home, and what does climate change mean to Colorado? And what can we expect to see here?
Well, I think climate change is very important to us. Obviously, it's very important to us because of skiing. In order to ski, you need, as I like to tell people, you need three things. You need cold, because we have to make snow a lot. Number two, you need snow, so you need water, you need liquid somehow. And you need gravity. And gravity, fortunately, is with us, and it hasn't gone away. The other two are variable, right? It is getting warmer. We have lost weeks in the fall, and we have lost weeks in the spring of ski season. It has now gotten less and less dependable, particularly in the fall, of whether or not it's going to get cold enough that we can make snow. And that is a very important thing to the ski industry, because as we know, Thanksgiving comes and we go on holiday. And those folks back east go on holiday. Those folks back east, anybody back east? Those folks back east, come here. We love you folks. Come, spend some money. Support Colorado's economy. I was told before that the ski industry here in Colorado is about a $12 billion a year industry. It is very important to us economically. I would also point out that as I've lived in Colorado for about 30 years, and I'm not a native, but that's getting me close. There's a certain ethic here. There's a certain Colorado-ness that we have. We like to get outside. This is a fantastically beautiful state. And part of that beauty is wrapped up in the climate, in the environment, in the weather that's out there. And maintaining that beauty for our kids and our grandkids is something that I think as Coloradans we all care about deeply.
So looking at some of the climate change projections, because that's probably why you're here, it's like, damn, tell me if I can go skiing or not in the next 10 years. Okay, so here are some climate change projections, and again, these folks were running 37 models, so we have a relatively high confidence level. On the top, what you can see is, so we have people running these climate models, and they're different models, and they're set up with different background conditions. All these models making predictions, and what they start out is they start out with the past. Because we have observations, we can compare the model, we can see how these models perform. And that's what you see here on the left-hand side. You see temperature, each of these yellow line is a model run, and then you see measurements in blue and green. And again, this is what you saw before. We have, and this is always the deviation from the normal. So we take the temperature over the last 100 years and then or 50 years, this is our standard, and then we look, is the temperature in this particular year warm or cold? If it's colder, then we have blue colors. If it's warmer, then we have red colors. So we can see that all of these models, more or less, they predict, actually all of these models very consistently project a temperature increase. If we are now actually zooming out, because these are global models, we're looking globally, if we're zooming out in Colorado, what does that mean? And here they also actually broke it up into seasons. You can see annual prediction with the last next, I think 50 years, but it doesn't matter that much. It's like about four degrees. And if you look at the breakdown in the seasons, you can see we will have most of the warming goes into the summer and into fall, and then winter stays a little bit below 3 degrees Fahrenheit. So we will expect very warm summers. And if we go back and look into how this affects precipitation, and the models are run the same way, so zero is the deviation from normal, and you see it's very hard to get actually signal from precipitation, because precipitation is so variable and it's very difficult to pinpoint that. And even in the projection, you see all these models that go up and down, and we cannot really see very significant increase. So again, if you average this over an entire year, you can probably just see like a 1 or 2%. However, if you actually break it down into seasons, you can see there's large variability in the summer, where the summer goes a little bit down. But what we can see is actually that precipitation increases in winter. So I have good news and I have bad news. Okay, so let's start with the bad news, because that's why you're here. Okay, so so now what we see is the precipitation as a function of height, of elevation. Okay, this is in meters, but it should not and not too much. So we see summers, and this is for Colorado. Summers will get drier, so these are the summer temperatures throughout the entire atmosphere. And if we look at red is the annual, but if we look at the winter precipitation, it will increase by this run about 40 millimeters. Okay, so if we now look, what will be the distribution between snow and water? And you can see that, and I put this line here, this is about, I think about 3,000 meters, about 9,000 feet. You can see, we look at winter, which is the blue line, you see that the snow will decrease, while the precipitation, the rain will increase. So we have some kind of a sweet spot where the temperature, the precipitation will increase and will come down as rain. However, if you go at a certain elevation, and that's why I think Colorado is a little bit more fortunate than other states, you see that this actually switches, and the increase in precipitation will come down as snow. Okay, so again, this is just one climate simulation. We still need to figure out where is this line. But the good news is that if you're high enough, because in this region, at least for the next few years, in this region, you get still enough cold days where you can get snow.
What
Keith can give you more, because this was like a pseudo climate. So we were just not really simulating time. We were just simulating the increase in temperature, and we did, I think, a two degrees Celsius increase. I know this now you're totally confused.
I'm going to hand the microphone over to Keith. I just want to. Sometimes it's difficult to understand what is 2 degrees, what is 4 degrees, and what does that really mean. So let me put a scale on that for you. If you go, 4 degrees is about how much warmer the planet was 40 million years ago, when it was warm enough that Antarctica was completely melted. Okay, so small changes in temperature have big impacts on this planet. So when scientists talk about 2 degrees, we are very nervous about 2 degrees. And when we talk about 4 degrees, we're talking about as much change as this planet has seen in 40 million years, okay? So that hopefully puts some kind of scale on that for you. Keith.
Thanks. So Katya kind of gave some results there of climate models, and I wanted to give a little background overview of climate models. There have been particularly great advances over the last couple of decades, and really the last decade in particular, in terms of our ability to model at high resolution the regional climate and the global climate. And by high resolution, I mean the spatial footprint at which we are running these models. It's particularly important for snow, because we need to be able to resolve the topography. We need to be able to resolve the mountain, the peaks, the valleys, because, you know, the climate varies over that elevation range. 2 decades ago, that was not possible with a climate model. And now we're able to run with large supercomputers, we're able to run these very fine scale. This is an example of I think it's a 4 kilometer resolution climate model run for, I think it was January and February. So we're looking at dynamics such as mountain snowstorms moving across the Pacific Northwest. That's the green, that's precipitation. We see this diurnal pulsing, which is evaporation from the surface and increasing our humidity, as the blue colors. And able to better characterize the general circulation. If you go to the next slide. We've gotten so good that actually the Colorado Avalanche Information Center this year brought on NCAR's best research weather forecasting model. And it's called WRF. These guys are running it in their basement on a computer system, which is awesome. And it's actually beating some of the best weather models in the world in terms of its accuracy of prediction. It's running some of the guy's basement, you know, and they're using this for snow and avalanche forecasting. Anyway, that didn't work, but if you go to the next slide, we can use these models to now resolve mountain snowpack. So all those processes we were observing in that funny time lapse of the snow depleting really quick, those are all processes that we need to treat in our land surface models with numerical algorithms, with mathematics, with fluid dynamics. So this is the local A Basin snowtell site compared to these high resolution numerical weather prediction models. So what we're looking at here is snowpack water equivalent. So this is how much water is in the form of the snow. If you were to melt that right away, this is how much water is in it. The gray shading is what we've seen measured at this snowtell station, which is just uphill a little ways from the resort, over the years 2000 and 2010. So it's an average here in the dashed line. And this is that simulated average run over those same 10 years, the climate model. And I want to emphasize how difficult this is and kind of how proud we are that we've advanced the science to the point where we can now start to resolve this. But what it allows us to do is then ask really important questions about what's going to happen in the future. So if you click the next slide. This is the simulated warming for the year 2085. So we've run the model again. We've run those 10 years, and we've run it again, but this time with emissions scenarios that are approximately what the IPCC believes we'll see on average for the year 2085 in terms of the emissions and how that'll feed back with the aerosols and the temperature. Approximately is about 4 degrees, 4.5 degrees Celsius by the year 2085. You can see this great reduction where snowpack that used to accumulate in October is now waiting until mid-November to start accumulating at this elevation. And then what used to melt out right near the end of the beginning of June is now closer to the beginning of May. So we're losing this shoulder season of snowpack. So if you go to the next slide, this is looking at air temperature. Now I've pulled out a model grid cell, a grid element of the model that is that corresponds to the mid-mountain elevation here at A Basin. This is temperature over that same 10-year period, maximum daily air temperature. And what shows up here is that the daily temperature in the winter is rarely above this 0 degrees Celsius, the freezing line, in the historic period. There might be three or four cases over a decade. Click the next. This is what the model thinks will happen by 2085, and you can see we're above that critical threshold way more frequently, every month, and probably every year in a warmer scenario. So now we can run this over not just a basin, but we can run this over North America, for example. So then we can start resolving and asking questions about snowpack. I just wanted to make a plug about NCAR's supercomputing capacity. It's kind of new. All right, we'll go to the next slide. It's based up in Cheyenne, Wyoming. We just brought on a new supercomputer. So with our previous supercomputer and this new one online, it's one of the largest computing centers in America. So what this is showing is a map of Colorado, Utah, Wyoming. I'm going to stand on the other side here. Of snowpack predictions, this is percent change under a business as usual, so no real change in greenhouse gas emissions over the next 70 years, over these states of Wyoming, Colorado, and the colors, blues, are really little change. It's within 5% of the historical. And so I think that's really important to highlight is that Katya's point about increasing precipitation also means that high elevations, more snowfall, and negligible change, really, in snowpack. While we might be losing those shoulder seasons, we're doing okay in Colorado. Summit County. The same is not true in the San Juans. These are seeing those yellows, oranges, and reds. Those are 20 to 30% reductions in snowpack. Utah, the greatest snow on Earth. These projections are suggesting that may not be the case. Yeah. Question? Oh, sorry.
She's objecting to your saying.
What this suggests is that Colorado may in the future be a sanctuary for skiing, and that's good news for the state. But with it comes a lot of responsibility, I think. And what this next slide is really sobering, so I'm going to take a breath. Okay, this is the projection for Western North America. I'm a little emotional. So the blacks are like, you've lost your snowpack. It's 70% reductions. Northern California, Tahoe, have lost their snowpack. The Pacific Northwest is mostly gone. The Canadian Coast Range, Whistler, they're in bad shape. Any place that today you might go there on a vacation and risk getting rained on. In a future climate, there's no snow. Even places in interior BC, Revelstoke, that we are excited about today, in the future, that's looking pretty dire. Canadian Rockies look like a refugia, a refuge for cold, because it's colder. The elevations aren't necessarily there, but they do have cold enough air from the Arctic. It's really Colorado that lights up.
Thank you, Keith.
Are you going to talk about what the factors are that are causing that? I mean, is it ocean temperatures? Is that a factor?
This is really mostly annual average air temperatures. So we believe that the climate models predict that in 2085 we'll have a four degrees Celsius warmer planet, which means that more of the storms that come in will be falling in the form of rain.
I've got an overriding question of what are the factors, the variables in the models. If this is a result, it's because you put a bunch of variables into the models and made assumptions about them.
They added more and more
greenhouse gases to the model. and that changes the
climate. Even though it says business as usual?
Business as usual means what we're doing today.
Okay, without any.
Without us saying, hey, we're going to switch over to solar or wind or something like that.
It's just pure greenhouse gas.
Well, it's doing what we're doing today.
Yes.
Today, about 85% of our energy comes from coal, oil, natural gas, and that's the same in that scenario in the future. That's what BAU means.
So, a really common question that we get is, what is the ski business, what's the ski industry doing about this? And at Arapahoe Basin, we're taking a three-pronged effect as to how we're trying to make an impact here. You know, first of all, we are trying to adapt what we're doing. We put more and more emphasis all the time on managing the snow, snow making, snow fencing, snow grooming, snow farming, trying to make conditions better with less snow all the time, in shorter seasons. We are working very hard to diversify what we offer. You know, if you've been hanging around Arapahoe Basin, you've seen we've done some more things. We've got a much bigger emphasis on food and beverage. We're trying to get people to enjoy coming here for a meal and enjoying time here. We're trying to put more emphasis on our ski school, which is not, you know, that person who's never skied before doesn't quite care as much if we have a 10-inch powder day or not. They want to take a lesson. We're trying more and more to come up with good, fun, interesting events for people to come and visit and talk to us. And we're really talking very seriously about things to do here in the summertime. You know, we have a successful wedding business going in the summer, and we're looking at other options to make this place exciting, interesting, and valuable for people to come to. We also do a lot of advocacy work. We work very closely with POW, and POW does great things, building an awareness about climate change, and they really deserve a round of applause for that. We work very closely with the National Ski Areas Association, which has a significant behind-the-scenes lobbying effort in Washington, trying to get change happening there. And on a local level, we have a great organization called the High Country Conservation Center, trying to get us all to have better practices. And then the third piece of what we're trying to do is we're really trying to do things. We're trying to reduce our carbon footprint. You see solar panels on our kids center. We just made a deal for a big heating control system improvement up at Black Mountain Lodge. All our snowcats, we buy a new snowcat every year, and this coming year we're going to be buying the first snowcat with a Tier 4 engine, which has a substantially decreased amount of greenhouse gases that come out of it. So we're really focused on doing these things. And if we don't lead by example on this, if the ski industry, if A Basin doesn't do that, I'm not sure who is. So, you guys have a closing comment or two? Okay.
Are you guys reaching out to other ski areas and try to partner with them? Because I know you guys do have a huge impact here working with POW. And I've walked around Black Mountain Lodge and see you guys use just regular cups. You wash them, you have compost, recycling. I just wonder if you guys are reaching out to other ski areas to do the same thing.
You know, the ski areas are pretty well networked on this, especially the people taking activity. And Sean, Mike, we're closely with a lot of people. There's an organization in Summit County that works with our local energy provider that all ski areas are participating in and trying to address those things. So there is a lot of commonality there.
I think the fact that ski areas, almost all of them, have sustainability directors is a pretty remarkable thing.
You know, Jim, that's a great point. And the fact that we have Shaw and Mike here working doing these things, that's probably because we are all busy doing stuff. We've got a lot of work to do every day, and they're the ones trying to keep us honest and moving forward in the right direction. So, yes?
You mentioned the kids center with the solar panel. How much energy do you produce here locally, solar, wind, or whatever?
That's you, Mike.
It's a 13.5 kilowatt array, which means at any given time, when they're not buried in snow and when it's fully sunny, they can create 13.5 kilowatts. What that means on the ground, it's about 20% of that building's use. And since we installed it just recently, 2 years ago, it's generated about 27 megawatts of energy.
So you have plans to put them on other buildings or not?
Well, I would say we're definitely looking into it, you know, as we improve our infrastructure and replace old roofs and, you know, replace our old buildings. I think any opportunity we have to, you know, install more on-site renewables will absolutely go down there.
Well, is it not, I'm questioning that because is it a question of money or is it a question of, say, doesn't look nice or whatever.
It's not a question of it doesn't look nice. It's a question of figuring out how to do it, figuring out how to pay for it, those kind of things. We actually think it looks really nice and think it adds. Steve.
I guess I have to have a fruit as well. Alan Melody from New York. My wife and I are avid skiers. We've been here for over 30 years. I'm also an environmental consultant. I've been working in this industry for about 40 years. I have to say something because these types of, this is great information, very important. Your audience needs to know that there are thousands of us, literally thousands of us, working every day trying to solve these problems. And I have to say, I work for private industry. I work for the people that you know cause that problem. We are, they're literally around the world. Scientists and engineers work every day to come up with better ways, to have renewable energy, better ways to have sustainable programs, innovation in industry, waste energy, trying to solve these problems to make sure that that business as usual on that graph doesn't happen. And it's not an easy task. We have much work to do. But I would say a comment, so the question was asked over here about what people could do. I would disagree. I think the way that you deal with this is look at the businesses that you frequent and that you buy things from. There are hundreds of thousands of businesses around this globe that do things in a responsible manner. And I must admit, most of them come from Europe and Asia. They're forcing U.S. companies to take a much different approach to how they do their businesses and how they deal with sustainable innovation in their products and services. Business lives on sales. This ski area lives on sales. You have to come here. They have to have the money to do these things. Al's absolutely right. This is a differentiating situation for a basin that, frankly, makes them a leader in their field. There are leaders in every other field. And I don't want people to leave here thinking that the whole planet is just doing business as usual. We are not. And thousands, millions, and billions of dollars literally are being spent to try to solve these problems.
Right. Thanks, Steve.
I guess I'd like to thank the panel for taking the time to address this issue. And my question to you is, you've been criticized, when you get out to tell the truth, the science, you've been criticized as being political. And how do you react to that? And how much more do you have to do to convince the naysayers?
Yeah, I find that criticizing scientists.
Yeah,
what? I'll repeat the question. So the question was, when we go out and speak in public like this, we sometimes get criticized for being political. How do we handle that? And interestingly, you know, we are not the political ones here. You know, we're the ones who are telling you this is how your planet works. I didn't design the planet, God did, okay? So we're the ones who look at it and say, this is how the thing functions. We're your messengers, right? The people who are politicizing this are the ones that you really have to go after. And I think even more so today. I mean, we've had a suggestion from the White House about a budget that cuts research, that cuts basic observations of how much CO2 is in the atmosphere. I think you know, As if you care about skiing, contact your congressperson, contact your senator, and say no. This is not a smart way to go. That's as political as I will get. But I think that that is really important.
Another thing that I felt helps is because I think because I deal also with students, because once people have a set mind, they have a set mind. It's sometimes very difficult to convince them otherwise. But try to connect with the same values. So if you feel people that are skiing and that have a different opinion, connect with them through skiing and explain to them that. I mean, I feel like sometimes it's very hard if you bombard people with facts and then they shut down and they won't say anything. But connect with this, find the same values that you have and connect to the same values and try to convince people, or at least show them facts and tell them these are facts.
Okay. Question.
What would have the biggest impact in not having a business as usual? Is it renewables? Is it sustainability? Is it, in the scientific, physical world?
Yeah, the biggest impact in terms of not going in this direction would be to do two things. One is to shift from fuels that produce CO2, carbon dioxide, coal, oil, natural gas. The other is to sequester it. If you're going to burn natural gas or coal, we have ways of removing the CO2. You can do that as well. The key is that a greenhouse gas is a greenhouse gas. And when you put it in the atmosphere, it's going to act like a greenhouse gas. So you got to find a way to either not put it in the atmosphere or take it back out of the atmosphere. That's how you don't go in that scenario.
Are renewables a good answer?
Renewables do not produce carbon dioxide nearly in the same amount. Solar, not at all. Wind, pretty much not at all. So nuclear, yeah. So these are alternatives that do not produce greenhouse gases. So yes, and yeah.
So we're winding down here. We'll do a couple more questions.
Something that's always interesting as far as climate change goes is population. I know Colorado is struggling with population, but I know as a whole, our country, the world is struggling with population. We talk a lot about what we do as humans. Is it more so because there are more of us now, or because we are behaving much worse?
So let's... If you think I've gotten up on a soapbox so far, you wait till you see this one. I'm about to, all right. Population, so there are two issues when it comes to climate change. One is how many people you have on the planet. We are on an exponential increase to 7.5 billion. In my lifetime, we've added 4 billion people to the planet. The other thing is how much we use individually. And in modern societies like ours, we use a lot of energy, we use a lot of fresh water, we use a lot of resources, okay? So as the world has industrialized, and God bless them, I want them to industrialize, yes, we burn more fossil fuels, we use more water. Now, population. Population is that's the underlying thing that you've got to get a hold of. Now, you talk to demographers, and you ask them, how do we control population? The number one way to control population on this planet is to empower women. When women have more economic power, when women have more political power, they have fewer children per woman, and they have those children later. Both of those things are natural, good mechanisms to get you to a lower population. Getting to a lower population actually means guys share a little bit more than you have in the past. Actually, a hell of a lot more than you have in the past. But yes, we got to deal with population. It can't be the third rail that you never talk about.
And you've been raising your hand the whole time there.
So I'm just curious, if this is your business as usual, really depressing picture, what does it look like if you meet the 1.8 or 2 degree centigrade cap as proposed in the Paris Agreement and so on and so forth? What does this picture look like?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. This simulation alone took a year to run on a supercomputer, so those are next steps, is to address exactly that, is to allocate resources to get money to run. You know, so we need more research, we need more science to answer exactly that question. This is a 4 degree warming scenario. It's relatively safe to say that in a 2 degree warming, it would be half of this impact, but not necessarily linear like that.
And usually when you see these different scenarios, basically what happens is like your temperature curve just goes ballistic.
Well, again, thank all you guys for coming today. Let's really thank Lindsay and back there. Elizabeth. Peter did a ton of the legwork to get this going, and Sean, Mike were so supportive of this. And you guys, wow, this exceeded every expectation I have. Thank you so much for coming. Turn off my mic. and let's all get out there and make a difference. Thank you.